Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents In Good Faith, A History of the Vietnam War, Volume 1, 1945 through 65, by Sergio Miller, narrated by Paul Woodson. Chapter 1, The Serpent in Eden, 1945 through 60. Yoshijiro Umezu, chief of the Army General Staff, bowed very low, as well he might. 3 weeks previously, his country had twice been visited by a divine, destructive wind beyond the imagination of man. It blew in from the east and was released from the bellies of two silver aircraft flying high above the clouds, barely visible except to an attentive observer. Imperial Japan had vowed that the flower of her youth would stop the relentless advance of the American foe. Even on the verge of defeat, and faced with the imminent invasion of the home islands, the Imperial Japanese headquarters plotted insane, fantastic attacks, involving 6,500 kamikaze pilots and 5,000 suicide boats to halt the invaders. If it came to it, the generals concluded, 100 million Japanese should sacrifice their lives and charge the enemy with swords and bayonets. America gave her answer with the thunderclap of two atomic bombs. Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer celebrated this novel way of annihilating entire populations by publishing a full-page advertisement of a bikini-clad model called Blanca Welter, Miss Anatomic Bomb, enjoying solar energy in an unexplosive moment, possibly the most vulgar documented response to the sudden, violent deaths of 150,000 human beings. Faced with annihilation, Emperor Hirohito made his jeweled-voice capitulation speech to the nation, in fact a broadcast of a barely intelligible pre-recorded statement spoken in archaic Japanese. The previous day, Japan had been attacked by the biggest air raid of the Pacific War, involving over 1,000 aircraft, dropping conventional but no less destructive bombs. An earlier mass leaflet drop revealing the Emperor's secret decision to surrender had raised fears of civil unrest. This last psychological operation, coupled with the unstoppable Soviet advance through Manchuria, sealed the capitulation. Later, detractors of the use of atomic weapons would ignore that, even in the very last hours of the war, Japan had to be pummeled into surrendering. The biggest shock of the atomic bomb was just how unshocked contemporaries were by its use. An 11-strong Japanese surrender delegation boarded the USS Missouri, anchored in Tokyo Bay on September 2, 1945. They were led by the bespectacled foreign minister, Mamoru Shigemitsu, dressed incongruously in tails, white gloves, and a top hat. His left hand gripped a walking stick, a curiously emaciated symbol of state propping his missing leg. General Umezu, with downturned mouth, wore his customary peaked cap, three rows of medals, and riding boots with spurs. He looked, like the rest of the party, drawn and beaten. The surrender ceremony lasted less than half an hour, watched in silence by the entire ship's company and 300 journalists and photographers. MacArthur led the proceedings, but Fleet Admiral Nimitz made sure his name was also on the instrument of surrender, with the distinction that he was signing on behalf of the American nation, whereas MacArthur was signing in his capacity as Supreme Commander Allied Forces. Immediately behind the table on which the surrender documents would be signed, in single rank, were representatives of all the other countries with a stake in the brief and now vanquished Japanese Empire. The old colonial powers, Britain, France, and the Netherlands, as well as the awakened giants, China and the Soviet Union. Under the terms of the surrender, only 4 of the 8 nations ranged against Japan were legally counted as an Allied power. The remainder were parties to the surrender. The French representative found himself relegated to the second rank of powers, along with minnows like New Zealand. Following the short ceremony, there could be no doubt that the Emperor God had been brought back down to earth, and a new deity resided on the summit of Mount Fuji. America now found herself the de jure ruler of an Asian country. Her western border stretched across 5,000 miles of ocean, and now lying on the rim of the most populous continent in the world. 5 years later, and using a football metaphor, Secretary of State Dean Acheson would call this America's new defense line against a fresh enemy, communism. The line snaked all the way from northern Japan to the southernmost islands of the Philippines, bypassing Korea with unintended consequences and stopping short of the remaining European colonies of Southeast Asia, including French Indochina. Like great military eruptions of the past, it left the conquerors both bewildered and fascinated by their new possessions. This was the first important consequence of the war in the Pacific. For the next four decades, facing down the Soviet Union became the monolithic, unifying theme of American foreign policy, and its abiding metaphor was the race in the development of new weapons, in space, in industrial output, and on sports tracks. Its constant fear was nuclear Armageddon. The better world that millions had fought for, if not a post-war Eden, then at least a place rid of the manifest evils of nationalist and totalitarian governments, had proved a child's fancy. A serpent had entered Eden, and its name was communism. The speed with which this happened forced a complete reversal of policy. If Moscow was going to play the discordant note to Washington's fiddle, then it was time to summon the marching bands. The hyperinflation of communism had profound consequences on American culture and self-image. Americans fought the Japanese to avenge a heinous wrong, trading war crime for war crime. But no American would have defined the essential character of Americanness as anti-Japanese. Despite the horrors perpetrated by the Nazi regime, the average GI held no strong feelings against the average German soldier. The lousy Kraut was a figure from the movies, and Patton's crude characterization of Germans was not shared by his Third Army, which just wanted to get the job done and come home. But communism, invariably spelled with a foreboding capital C, was absolutely different. The dreary ruminations of Karl Marx, read nowhere outside university campuses, became the words of the devil. Communism grew the horns of religious evil, not just political wrong or economic stupidity, threatening the very beacon on the hill the Puritans had first lit. The immediate post-war tension was and would remain in Europe. This was where vast armies still faced each other across Churchill's Iron Curtain. But a second front also opened in Asia, where the end of hostilities brought to the surface the many intractable problems exposed by the receding tide of Japanese imperialism. And it was here that America faced, in MacArthur's colorful phrase, a hard, monolithic block of China and Russia with no crevices in it. All the principal actors viewed the post-war settlement through the lens of their own ambitions and ideologies, and the outcome was always going to be more wars. For the French and Dutch, a return to the status quo ante was the logical resolution, and they were at first surprised and then resistant when they discovered that the newly liberated peoples of their former colonies no longer welcomed them. "Better to the hell than to be colonized again," ran the slogan on the sides of buses in Java, where British tanks and Thunderbolt aircraft were used to suppress rebellion against the war-exhausted Dutch. The British themselves were divided. But the more reasonable voices foresaw the end of empire and sought to manage Britain's disengagement from her far eastern colonies with equity and dignity. Australia and New Zealand had no imperial designs, although both administered a handful of colonial possessions, but eyed developments to the north with wariness. The long, indefensible coastline of Australia had been exposed by the Japanese. Could it happen again, with the threat of now communist-inspired liberation movements? From Moscow's onion-domed towers, Stalin saw the opportunity to gobble former disputed territories, tidy borders, and spread Soviet influence across the Far East. Nationalist China, exhausted by civil war, parleyed with the Red Army, but the relation was strained and would eventually break down. For America, the undisputed victor, the war had been fought to replace totalitarianism with democracy, and especially to champion self-determination, an ideal incompatible with the ambitions of the former colonial powers. Exhausted by this epic war, Washington first settled for Japan and then looked beyond to China, surrendering the complicated ethnic tangle of Southeast Asia to the Europeans. For the myriad native peoples who had witnessed the humiliation of European masters at the hands of an Asian army, the moment was ripe for revolt. With historical hindsight, the war against Japan proved to be only one of several wars that would ravage East Asia over the subsequent decades. The vacuum of retreating colonialism, swiftly sucking in superpower competition, was one agent, But nationalism and sectarianism, internal power struggles and land grabbing, much of which masqueraded as liberation movements, also played important roles. This sparking of general, region-wide conflagration was the second great consequence of the war. For post-war generations of Western Europeans brought up to celebrate the Normandy landings, the sheer scale of America's Pacific struggle was as difficult to comprehend as it was remote. The armed forces of the United States conducted 78 amphibious landing operations over the course of the Pacific War, with the last launched at Sarangani Bay on July 12, 1945. By that summer, U.S. forces had occupied the Ryukyu and Rettō Island archipelagos just south of Japan and were within 200 miles of the mainland. It had been a supreme effort. For the average GI or Marine who lived through the experience, vengeance was all that counted, and the ticket home. It took almost 4 years to defeat Japan because of the geographical scale of the war and the necessity to fight on a second European front. But mostly the war was prolonged because Japan opposed Western military competence with ideological fanaticism. This feature of the war would be repeated in every subsequent conflict in Southeast Asia, where Western and Asian soldiers clashed. America suffered 106,207 war dead in the Pacific War. Her main ally, the British, suffered 52,000 fatalities, including 12,000 deaths in captivity. A further 86,838 British Indians added to this toll. By contrast, Japan suffered 2,133,915 military deaths from 1937 to 1945. As a very rough measure, American forces were perhaps inflicting 20 times as many fatalities on their enemy. The American way of war, at the very least, was a lethally effective way. The Pacific War not only proved an industrially murderous business, it was also an especially dehumanizing experience for the frontline soldier. A popular wartime poster urged U.S. servicemen to stay on the job until every murdering Jap is wiped out. This invocation was observed with a bloodlust that matched the abhorrent ideology of the Japanese Imperial Forces. By the end of the war, soldiers returning from the Pacific Theater had to make a customs declaration that they were not carrying body parts in their luggage. Never mind wiping out the Japanese, chop them to pieces and pickle them. When the remains of Japanese soldiers were repatriated from the Mariana Islands in the mid-1980s, it was discovered that 6 out of 10 were missing their heads. The same phenomenon of headless, as well as toothless or earless Japanese corpses was repeated across the Pacific Islands. Directives condemning and prohibiting the practice of collecting body parts as souvenirs were widely ignored. When Life magazine in May 1944 notoriously published the image of a young woman posing with the skull of a Japanese soldier sent to her by her naval officer boyfriend, there was pious public condemnation. But this censure missed the mood of a nation that viewed trophy skulls as legitimate spoils of war. "This is a good Jap, a dead one picked up on the New Guinea beach." Miss Nickerson, unfazed by the macabre gift, named the skull Tojo, after the Japanese general who ordered the attack on Pearl Harbor. The real Tojo kept his head long enough for it to be hung for war crimes in December 1948, but not his teeth. A 22-year-old Navy dentist called Jack Mallory rectified this by providing him with a set of dentures with the words "Remember Pearl Harbor" inscribed in Morse code as a prank. The War Department objected to the Life magazine cover, not because it was morally repellent, but because it endangered the lives of U.S. servicemen who might themselves be turned into Japanese body part trophies. The naval officer who sent the skull got away with a reprimand. As far as the Life editor was concerned, there was no wrongdoing. Did not the government's own propaganda describe the Japanese as rats, vermin, reptiles, apes, monkeys, bats, and insects? A Japanese skull was just one more animal trophy. This sense of racial superiority over the yellow Asiatic enemy, engendered in the Pacific and fortified in the Korean War, would multiply with frightful results in the Vietnam War. The tragic paradox of America as idealistic guarantor of liberty, but acting as out-of-control mobster, was the third great consequence of the Pacific War. Americans wanted to remember the war by the heroic, if staged, image of Marines hoisting the Stars and Stripes on Mount Suribachi, not by film of American soldiers shooting prone Japanese prisoners and hacking them with bayonets, footage that would only emerge 50 years after the conclusion of the Pacific War. The country least willing to accept the new political order was France. Not so much a nation as an idea that emerged from the Second World War in a mess, bankrupted but with undimmed imperial ambitions. Restoring la gloire française, French glory, quickened the pulse of every Frenchman, communists as much as Gaullists. Even as other European countries were preparing to unwind their colonial histories, France's soon-to-be Fourth Republic embarked on a suicidal project to retain her overseas possessions, and the first colony to challenge this vision was French Indochina. When traveler Pierre Barallon visited Indochina in 1893, for the benefit of readers of the popular weekly journal Le Tour du Monde, he wrote, "Le Cap Saint-Jacques est en vue, c'est la terre française. Cape St. Jacques is in view. This is French land." Half a century later, any Frenchman would have agreed with him. As early as September 1943, under the leadership of General Charles de Gaulle, a committee of national defense had been tasked with planning the recapture of Indochina. For administrative purposes, modern Vietnam was then a colony divided along the lines of its three historic regions: northern Tonkin, Bac Bo, with Hanoi as capital; central Annam, Trung Bo, administered by Hue, the imperial capital; and Cochin China, Nam Bo, served by cosmopolitan Saigon. The name Vietnam was a modern coinage. Vietnam's late imperial dynasties had governed a kingdom named Nam Viet, or South Viet. Chinese invaders reversed the name to Vietnam. The imperial court in Hue used the title Dai Nam, or Great South, up to the end of 1945. It was northern nationalists, led by the communists, who revived the title Vietnam, claiming it for their Democratic Republic of Vietnam. The French, of course, denied any such identity. When future Central Committee member Hoàng Quốc Việt worked his passage on a French ship, he proudly declared himself a Vietnamese. But his fellow French sailors shot back, "There was no such thing as Vietnam." Vietnamese history and identity had been defined by rivalry between these various ethnic blocs. Over a period of centuries, northern Vietnamese rulers had extended their rule over Annam and later Cochin China. This became the historic mission inherited by Vietnam's communist leaders. In their way stood the flotsam of a century of French colonialism that had four profound effects on Vietnamese society. In the political sphere, the imperial elite and Mandarin classes had been demoralized and eventually dismantled. Economically, traditional land ownership had given way to industrial estates and a rapacious rentier culture. It was said that the workers were fertilizer for the rubber trees because they died in droves and were buried in the plantations. This was an inevitable consequence of Paris designating the Indochinese possessions a colonie d'exploitation, colony of economic exploitation. The corollary to this deracination was social upheaval within an urban working class and a growing and educated middle class fed on a staple of French culture. Incongruously, Vietnamese were taught that their ancestors were Gauls. Lastly, the division between North and South was reinforced by policies that favored local French caciques, party bosses, over national unity. Roosevelt was absolutely right when he observed, "France has milked it, Vietnam, for 100 years. Ho Chi Minh would quip that the French built more prisons than schools. A legacy of Belle Époque public buildings barely compensated for these pernicious outcomes. This was Graham Greene's Vietnam of urine and injustices, taboo and illusion, dirty magazines, and restaurants with grill entrances to ward off grenade attacks." Life correspondent Theodore H. White, with his deep knowledge of Indochina, sketched it best. "The splendid French boulevards ran like causeways over a basin of hate." France's humiliation in Indochina began in June 1940, when Japan demanded the closure of the Haiphong-Yunnan Railway, used to supply nationalist forces in China. General Georges Catrou, the governor-general and an officer steeped in the French colonial experience, had no option but to accede to the demand. For many months, he had conducted a skillful diplomatic game with Tokyo in an effort to preserve the unity of the French colony, cognizant that his 90,000-strong Indochina army was a paper force. Just 14,500 were reliable Europeans. Trapped by the feebleness of the French position, Catrou concocted the notion of a face-saving defensive alliance with Japan. His interlocutor, the Francophobe General Nishihara, an officer who had served as defense attaché in Paris, readily agreed to this proposal. 2 months later, on September 22nd, his Vichy government replacement, Vice Admiral Jean Decoux, endured greater humiliation. Faced with the ultimatum of an invasion, France agreed to the stationing of 6,000 Japanese troops on Vietnamese soil. A fiction of Japanese-French amity was preserved, but the reality was that the Japanese 5th Division had effectively ousted Decoux as the supreme authority in the country. To sustain this false narrative, a neutered French garrison was allowed to remain in territories now forcibly co-opted into Japan's greater East Asian prosperity sphere. Decoux proved an energetic governor-general, as keen at hunting down the Bolshevist common enemy as building roads. But in making common cause with the Japanese, he had manifested a supreme hypocrisy that infected every subsequent French colonial government. A facade of greater Vietnamese participation in government masked an iron determination to resist the twin threats of a total Japanese takeover and Vietnamese nationalism. His government's policy, he explained at a secret meeting of Résidence Supérieure, the French ruling class, in Dalat in July 1942, was to play all sides against each other, maintaining as friendly relations with Japan as possible, while keeping lines of communication open with nationalist China and the Allies. The Japanese similarly played a double game, in public supporting the French authorities, but in private supporting subversive groups like the Hoa Hao Buddhists and the Cao Dai sect. From the Japanese perspective, Vietnam's sects were little more than peculiar minority movements, but they served the purpose of destabilizing French authority. The latter's full title was Dai Dao Tam Ki Pho Do, or the Great Religion of the Third Amnesty. Founded by the probably mad Ngô Văn Chu, the Cao Dai was an occult, syncretic movement borrowing from Christianity, Buddhism, and Taoism. Its saints included such diverse figures as Joan of Arc, the Chinese revolutionary Sun Yat-sen, and French author Victor Hugo. There were as many as 2 million Cao Daiists, mainly in Tai Ninh province northwest of Saigon, and they owed allegiance to a self-proclaimed pope, Pham Cong Thach, not the government. The Hoa Haos were formed by another religious fanatic, a Buddhist faith healer called Huang Phu So, who would be executed by the Viet Minh, turning the two movements into implacable enemies. There were perhaps 1.5 million Hoa Haos, mostly settled in the Mekong Delta. As the Pacific War expanded, tensions within Indochina multiplied. Gaullists and Vichy supporters schemed against each other, fomented by British intelligence. In the background, an austere wartime economy began to spiral out of control. The cost of a chicken jumped from just over half a piaster in 1939 to 18 piasters by 1945. The cost of a kilo of rice multiplied 20-fold. In May 1941, across the Chinese border in Guangxi province, Vietnamese exiles anticipating the end of French rule formed the Vietnam Doc Lap Dong Minh Hoi, the League for the Independence of Vietnam. This movement embraced a coalition of the veteran Indo-Chinese Communist Party, Vietnam Cong San Dang, ICP, the rival Vietnamese Nationalist Party, Vietnam Quoc Dan Dang, VNQDD, and two smaller parties, the New Vietnam Party and the Revolutionary Youth League. Nationalist Chinese attempts to manipulate the last three parties led to their loss of credibility and elevated the communists as the only genuine and independent Vietnamese nationalist cause. Internecine struggles then led to the dissolution of the ICP, leaving political leadership in the hands of a handful of armed men. Among the founding members of this resistance was the bone-thin, itinerant political activist later known to the world as Ho Chi Minh. His deputy was a former teacher and newspaper man with an interest in military history called Vo Nguyen Zap. The two had first met as students at the prestigious Lycée Quoc Hoc in Hue, the incubator of many of Vietnam's future leaders. Since those days, both had suffered hardship, imprisonment, and in the case of Zap, the loss of his wife, tortured in Hau Lo prison, where American pilots would later be incarcerated. Zap was entrusted with establishing the first fighting cadres of a rudimentary guerrilla force, the Viet Minh, meaning Light of the Land. Vo meant force, and Zap, shield, apt names for the future commander of Vietnam's communist forces. With an insurgent war churning around him, he was not short of inspiration. For the first 4 years, the Viet Minh achieved little militarily, partly because of the success of repressive measures introduced by Decoux. The Bureau de Statistique Militaire, the Army's intelligence service, proved especially effective in this regard. The first formal Viet Minh units were not raised until December 1944, and no significant actions were taken before March 1945. All the while, however, a covert, rural-based infrastructure was being painstakingly built, which would provide the foundation for future success. This seeming inactivity was also driven by Ho's painful experience of the failed November 22, 1940 uprising against the French, a half-cooked revolution, he concluded, was worse than no revolution at all. The Viet Minh were not isolated during this period of gestation. Nationalist China provided some material support and sanctuary. American support, which marked the beginning of direct American involvement in Vietnam and hence has a foundling quality about it, started with the Roosevelt government through the Office of Strategic Services, OSS. The first mention of Ho Chi Minh was made in OSS files dating to 1940. Secret arms shipments to the Viet Minh were made in 1942 and 1943, although there is some suggestion that the American suppliers were unclear who was actually receiving the weapons. The OSS was followed by bombers. In a foretaste of future raids, a sortie was conducted by 14th Air Force against Hanoi on April 12, 1943, that resulted in nearly 500 Vietnamese deaths, but only a handful of Japanese casualties. A raid on the docks of Saigon, on May 5, 1944, produced similar results. It was not until 1945 that B-29 and 3rd Carrier Fleet raids began to inflict worthwhile damage on the Japanese war effort in Indochina, but these attacks also witnessed high numbers of civilian casualties, including Europeans. Pitching French Indochina into the hands of Wild Bill Donovan's OSS, rather than subsuming it within MacArthur's military command, had other important consequences. Donovan was strongly opposed to the French regime in Indochina, viewing Vichy colonialism as little better than Japanese imperialism. Anti-French sentiment imbued the Indochinese mission from the beginning, and would continue to complicate Franco-American relations for the next decade. A Viet Minh eruption in northern Vietnam was finally precipitated by the unannounced Japanese attack on a weakened French garrison, codenamed Operation Mego Sakusen, on March 9, 1945. The coup was launched at precisely the same moment that Roosevelt was privately advising the French government there would be no Allied military action in French Indochina. De Gaulle had warned Roosevelt that the collapse of the Vichy government would encourage the Japanese government to at least subjugate the French administration in the Union of Indochina, and so it came to pass. By now, 5th Division had been replaced by 38th Army, commanded by Lieutenant General Yuitsu Tsuchihashi. The French were not entirely caught by surprise. Secret Japanese plans to seize control of French Indochina had been known to the French authorities for quite some time, thanks to American code-breaking. Ever suspicious of Washington's motives, some had discounted this valuable intelligence. Command of the colonial army in Hanoi fell under Lieutenant General Eugène Mordaunt. This old-fashioned general with an exuberant walrus mustache took the warnings seriously and prepared a contingency known as Plan A-835-3. This would see French forces withdrawing to the hills of the Red River Delta to await reinforcement, a forlorn hope. Operation Mego Sakusen unrolled irresistibly and ruthlessly. Despite spirited local French resistance, Plan A became a retreat. One of the more encouraging aspects of this otherwise desperate action was the manner in which the French and Viet Minh briefly found common cause against the Japanese enemy. But by May 2nd, the last soldiers of the demoralized French Indochina army had crossed the Chinese border, leaving behind only scattered bands of partisans. There they found an American ill will and a refusal by General Albert Wedemeyer, chief of staff of the Southeast Asia Command, to treat the French soldiers as anything other than refugees. This contrary position with the French was the handiwork of the now deceased Roosevelt. To the end of his life and presidency, Roosevelt clung to the policy that America should not follow France, or any other European power, to bank the lives of U.S. servicemen to save Asian empires, a policy he personally conveyed to Wedemeyer in March 1945. This conflicted with directives issued by the Joint Chiefs to assist the French, as long as the assistance met American war aims and could not be construed as offering political support for the Vichy colonial authorities. In practice, the two aims could not be easily separated. A bombing run served the purpose both of giving the Japanese hell and succor to the French. Even as a chorus of French officers led by de Gaulle complained that 14th Air Force was not doing enough, U.S. State Department officials fretted that they were doing too much. The two principal outcomes that fell out of this unhappy alliance were a reinforced French mistrust of Washington's intentions and an opportunity for the anti-Gallic OSS to fill the vacuum left by the departing French, an opportunity Donovan did not pass by. Even as the Allies squabbled, Japanese hopes of Vietnamese compliance were quickly dashed. Abrogation of the 1884 Pater Notre Treaty and a Declaration of Independence failed to satisfy Vietnamese nationalism. Among those who felt thwarted was a future president of South Vietnam, who would so perplex and frustrate American policymakers, the Catholic Ngô Đình Diệm. A haltingly efficient government was established under a progressive politician named Tran Trong Kim, but it was evident that French Indochina, without the French, was no more pacified. Within the month, Ho convened a conference of armed groups in northern Vietnam. The six provinces that constituted the self-proclaimed free zone of the Viet Bac, and announced the formation of a 5,000-strong Vietnam Liberation Army. Confusingly, the now puppet emperor, Bao Dai, simultaneously raised an army with the same title. It was at this juncture that the newly arrived and exotically named OSS captain, Archimedes Leonidas Attilio Patti, crossed paths with Ho Chi Minh. Chain-smoking Chesterfields, Patti later recalled, "I first met Ho on the China border between China and Indochina in the last days of April of 1945. He was an interesting individual. Very sensitive, very gentle, rather a frail type. We spoke quite at length about the general situation, not only in Indochina, but the world at large." In Patti's later fascinating 600-page account, Why Vietnam, Prelude to America's Albatross, he explained that he actually knew very little about the man. He first noticed the name in a cable to the U.S. ambassador in China dated December 31, 1942, describing the arrest by Chinese authorities of one Ho Chi Chi in Kunming. A year later, there was a request for his release. On August 28, 1944, there was a visa request to travel to the United States for a Ho Ting Ching, an intriguing suggestion that Ho intended to make his advocacy directly to Roosevelt. He didn't, in the end, travel because the Chinese would not issue him with a passport. When Patti asked about this individual, fellow Americans described him as a friendly Annamite. Ho impressed on Patti the dire situation of the Vietnamese in Tonkin, at the time facing famine because the French were selling rice stocks to the Japanese as well as using them to supply the lucrative rice wine business. In turn, the Japanese had exacerbated the plight of farmers by forcing them to grow hemp to support the war effort. Patti later recalled that Ho showed him a collection of photographs of famine victims. "We look at the Cambodian pictures today and compare them with those, well, there's no comparison. Really, those were sad." Hanoi medical student Tran Duy Hung remembered, "Hanoi was full of agonizing sights at the time. People dug into the garbage dumps in order to find any edible thing at all. Banana peels, tangerine peels, discarded greens, and vegetable, and so on. They also ate rats. Every morning when we opened our door, we saw 5 to 7 corpses of people who had died the night before. Villager Duong Van Tang, like hundreds of his fellow peasants, joined the Viet Minh to escape the ravages provoked by the French and Japanese. We simply died in droves because of starvation, simply dried up and died. To Patty's surprise, Ho asked for nothing except an open line to the OSS. Not only was Patty surprised, but when he reported back to the OSS stations in Kunming and Chongqing, they wouldn't believe me. The Viet Minh duly supplied the intelligence, which was judged fantastic and so accurate, intelligence staffs in Chongqing and Kunming changed their orders of battle and targeting. However, OSS agents did provide support for America's future nemesis. When Ho fell seriously ill with malaria and dysentery, it was an American doctor, Paul Hoagland, who saved him. Following the abdication of Emperor Bao Dai in September 1945, it was Patty who gave the unauthorized imprimatur to Ho's unilateral declaration of independence in Ba Ding Square, actually a roundabout on the corner of the Jardin Botanique in Hanoi, and it was an American aircraft that provided an unintended flypast. For Patty, it was always clear that Ho's men were fighting for the cause of independence against the French. Ho reciprocated by professing undying friendship with the new, powerful ally. Patty later confessed, "I just couldn't believe my own ears." In fact, by the time Patty assumed responsibility for FIC, French Indochina operations, a narrative of undercover missions had been underway for some time. An AGAS, Air Ground Aid Station, China, operator, Lieutenant Charles Fenn, later an author, had made separate contact with Ho in March 1945, following the downing of an American pilot. A second AGAS operator, Lieutenant Dan Phelan, sent glowing reports of the Viet Minh in May. Later, a Major Allison Thomas joined Patty's team, brimming with confidence after working in occupied France with the French resistance. Under an existing nebulous, mysterious GBT, after the initials of the surnames of the three men who took part, Lawrence Gordon, Harry Bernard, and Frank Tan, covert operations were being undertaken in Tonkin in support of the Allied bombing. These missions also involved intermittent liaison with Ho's Viet Minh, who were keen to help the Americans. GBT had all the hallmarks of freewheeling wartime espionage operations. Gordon was a Canadian expatriate who had managed Texaco's operations in Haiphong before the war. Bernard was a British tobacco dealer, and Tan a Chinese-American businessman. The ring had in fact been set up by the British Secret Service, which caused some friction with the Arriviste OSS. The newly arrived Major Thomas, who was only partly aware of GBT, judged that one of the operators, never identified, offered the best intelligence, although OSS controllers treated his reports with a pinch of salt. It was this mysterious individual who presciently warned Thomas that it would be impossible to work with the French in FIC. Over May and June 1945, the main effort was the mounting of a Franco-American operation from Taingai on the Sino-Tonkin border. For a combination of reasons, not least a growing realization that collaboration with the French would not be welcomed, this scheme fell apart. During this period, after some deliberations, it was decided the Viet Minh constituted a potentially useful ally against the Japanese. The deciding factor was the loss of French intelligence contacts with Tonkin. As far as anyone knew, the only organized group capable of filling the gap was precisely the guerrilla movement generally known as the Viet Minh League. Much like Patty, Thomas later confessed that he had barely heard of the Viet Minh, and that the first mention of this group was in conversation with French officers. Fenn may have played a key role in offering to make contact with the Viet Minh, as he had quizzed Ho on his communist affiliations, the main concern of the American backers, and concluded that he was basically a nationalist. This line was reinforced by Patty. French contacts insisted that the Vietnamese were stupid, infantile, and communist, but Patty dismissed this jaundiced advice. The OSS subsequently organized a covert operation, the six-man deer mission led by Allison Thomas. The team comprised Lieutenant Montfort, a French army officer, Sergeant Logo, a French Annamite, Sergeant Fach, also an Annamite, a third Sergeant Zelski, and the French and Vietnamese-speaking Private Prunier. The group parachuted into Tonkin on July 16th, near a village called Kim Lung, 75 miles northwest of Hanoi, where contact was made with Ho's guerrillas. Among the welcoming committee was Van, the nom de guerre of Vo Nguyen Zap, incongruously and impeccably dressed in a white suit and fedora. Their task, according to Thomas, was to interdict Japanese lines of communication in the Hanoi-Ningmai area, gather intelligence on the Japanese, including targets of opportunity for the Air Force, and train a group of 100 guerrillas in small arms. In return, the guerrillas offered assistance to downed Allied pilots under the scheme earlier organized by Fenn. Ho acquired the code name Lucius, as well as the more prosaic label OSS Agent 19. Incongruously, Prunier noticed that Ho used stationery from the Parker House Hotel in Boston, a city he had visited as a young man. In addition to Ho and Zap, this core group gave rise to at least two general officers, including Major General Quang Trung, who would first vex the French and then the Americans during the Vietnam War. "This particular group was a select group from all over Vietnam," said Prunier. "They weren't a ragtag bunch of farmers." The OSS men and Viet Minh quickly established a good rapport, facilitated by a welcoming supper of beer, recently captured, rice, bamboo sprouts, and barbecued steak. The Deer Mission was impressed that the guerrillas freshly slaughtered a cow in our honor. Ho assured his guests that he would welcome 10 million Americans into Tonkin, but no French. The Frenchman Montfort, in fact, was lucky to have escaped with his life. As Ho later explained, his guards would have shot him dead on the spot had they known his identity. Montfort was later flown out for his safety. It transpired, to Franco-American mutual embarrassment, that Montfort was in fact an M5 French Secret Service agent who had infiltrated the OSS. Logo and Fach were also double agents in a piece of brazen French chicanery. Thomas's opinion on the Viet Minh was quickly formed. In his preliminary report to the OSS base in Kunming, he wrote, "Forget the communist bogey. VML, Viet Minh League, is not communist, stands for freedom and reform from French harshness." He was wrong on the first point, but right on the second. Ho was both communist and nationalist, a juxtaposition that simplistic American labeling could not reconcile. In the end, the Deer Mission achieved little. Military support was neither substantial nor decisive, and various delays meant the guerrilla force was still in training when the Japanese surrender was announced. The only fighting undertaken by Thomas's trainees was a desultory affair against an isolated Japanese contingent in the town of Tai Nguyen, where the Three-Nation Truce Commission would in fact sit at the end of the First Indochina War. After some negotiations, a truce was called, and the Japs were allowed to circulate in the town without arms, where they were surprised to find equally surprised Americans out strolling the streets on a shopping and picture-taking tour. It was during this heady period that another OSS operator crossed paths with Ho and Zap, a Franco-American called Lucien Conin. The young captain just wanted to get the hell out of there and return home, like so many other servicemen stuck in backwaters. In time, he would return to South Vietnam and play a central role in the final drama of the Kennedy presidency. Thomas's untrammeled support for Ho, in the meantime, caused discord in the Deer Mission camp. Another Franco-American called De Forneau alleged that the boys hated Thomas and his pro-Viet Minh ways. Conin, in turn, fell out with Patty in Hanoi, whom he judged arrogant. These tensions in the American camp aside, it had always been Ho's policy anyway to avoid confrontation with the Japanese, for fear of being worsted, in the same way that he had avoided conflict with his Chinese hosts. In reality, the Viet Minh undertook just one independent action against the Japanese in the entire war. Ho's reputation as nationalist leader was based on the blare of propaganda, good organization at village level, but little martial substance. His real enemies were competing Vietnamese political groups, maneuvering to seek power following the anticipated collapse of French colonial rule. Unlike his fellow communists, Ho was well-traveled and had seen at first hand the great engine of America when he worked his passage to New York as a young man. He instinctively understood this was the power that counted, not a fracturing China, the traditional enemy of Vietnam anyway. Ho accepted the military assistance and reciprocated with intelligence, but what he really wanted was political recognition. Every educated Vietnamese was acutely aware of Roosevelt's promise of independence made in the 1941 Atlantic Charter. In their first meeting, Patty had been taken aback when Ho quoted Wilson's 14 points by rote. These were nationalists steeped in the rhetoric of an American promised independence. However, the OSS mission was not in a position to fulfill such promises. Both the OSS and Viet Minh were unaware that Secretary of State Stettinius had secretly promised his French counterpart that Washington would respect the status of French Indochina. Ignorant of this deal, Ho continued to act as if independence was imminent. There followed an exchange of messages with Washington, which Ho used to press his case as Vietnam's legitimate future head of state. The Viet Minh was portrayed as a genuinely popular movement backed by Buddhists, Christians, businessmen, and farmers. The possibility of an American naval base at Cam Ranh Bay was mooted. Trade between the two countries was offered. In Hanoi, a gigantic Stars and Stripes was somehow found in the war-ravaged city. On August 26th, Zapp organized a band to play the American national anthem outside the accommodation of the OSS team while he saluted the unfurled flag. He could hardly have done more to ingratiate himself with a nation that would go to war against him. 4 days later, the Viet Minh League cleverly arranged UP news coverage of an anti-French protest that passed outside the Hotel Metropole. All the placards were in English, but none of the Vietnamese, of course, were English speakers. This trick of playing to American public opinion would be repeated with great effect in the later war. That Ho, one-time student of communism in Moscow, was courting the capitalists did not go unnoticed. Patty soon made contact with the Soviet spook, a polyglot called Stefan Solosiev, a pleasant man in his late 40s with an open smile and a direct approach. There were around 500 or 600 Soviet citizens in Indochina, several hundred serving in the French Foreign Legion. Indeed, there was a flourishing communist apparatus within the Legion, a small corps actually absconding and fighting for the Viet Minh. Solosiev, like all the other secret agents who had descended on Hanoi, was concerning himself with the welfare of nationals, as well as attending to many other matters. The pair drank vodka for several hours. Solosiev proved eminently sensible and perceptive. Nothing could stop the Vietnamese drive for independence. The French should ease this process, and the Americans should provide technical assistance. The Soviet Union, he honestly confided to Patty, had no stake in this corner of Southeast Asia. American in-country reporting continued to portray Ho as a symbol of nationalism and the struggle for freedom to the overwhelming majority of the population. It was this perspective that had led Patty to open a temporary OSS office in the Hotel Metropole in Hanoi and to participate, as supportive bystander, in the Viet Minh August Revolution and Declaration of Independence. Patty arrived in Hanoi alongside Jean Saint-Denis, the French head of intelligence, and was impressed by the support for Ho. I said, "Jean, it doesn't look like it's going to be very good, is it?" And he shook his head and was absolutely stunned by the display of anti-French sentiment, and also by the display of the red flag with the gold star. Later, he fell into a depressed silence. Depression soon turned to dismay when he awoke to read the headline in the local press. "Viet Minh fighting with U.S. troops in Tonkin will soon be here to oust the French oppressors who last year starved 2 million people." Santini's dismay deepened over the manner in which Hanoi fell into the lap of Ho and his supporters. "Certain myths have sprung up over the years over the taking of Hanoi," Patty later recorded. "There was no coup d'etat, no bloodshed, no reprisals, no French resistance, no secret plot or arrangement with the Japanese, not even substantive Vietnamese aid from outside Hanoi. The communists were simply the best organized group, and Ho Chi Minh the only figure of stature known to the Tonkinese. The Japanese, under General Tsuchihashi, had emptied the bank of Indochina, but otherwise stood aside. The significance of the act, however, was unmissable, and news of Ho Chi Minh's success in Hanoi spread like wildfire. The Viet Minh primarily sought American moral support, and were prepared to play a propaganda war to win that support. Patty remained supportive, even if his government was turning a deaf ear to Ho's blandishments. The chances that Washington would respond to this correspondence, in fact, were remote. Vietnam had fallen down the list of concerns in the State Department. Roosevelt died on February 12th, before the OSS mission initiated its contacts with the Viet Minh. As far as Patty could discern, there really was no Indochinese policy, except keeping the French out. Accommodating a Vietnamese liberation movement, and only one of several with competing claims in French Indochina, was never going to gain Truman's attention in the first few months of his presidency. At the time, the Division of Southeast Asian Affairs in the State Department was headed by the bald, bespectacled Abbott Lowe Moffat, who held the post over the crucial years 1944 through 47. Indochina's mysterious peoples were judged relatively small potatoes in world affairs. Roosevelt's policy had been spare and barely articulated. Moffat received one brief memo from Roosevelt on the subject. "That was," he recalled, "the full instructions that we had, period." At Roosevelt's insistence, no aid was to be furnished to the French, but material assistance continued to arrive in clandestine ways, or later with the complicity of the British. Moffat reported these activities to the White House, receiving the peremptory reply, "This must stop," but they continued anyway. At Yalta, Moffat's department was outflanked by the European lobby, supporting France, and an older and sicker Roosevelt gave up on the issue of trusteeship. More accurately, he agreed to the evasion of trusteeship with the French as trustee, or an effective return to colonial rule. The European lobby dismissed Moffat's fussing over Indochina and as casually dismissed Indochinese nationalism as just the result of Japanese propaganda. When Roosevelt died, it was the European department that reacted first, forwarding a memo to Truman. "The department thinks it's time to change our policy and begin furnishing military aid to the French." Once again outflanked, my staff was practically ready to lynch me, Moffat was forced to compromise. Ironically, Stettinius rejected the compromise paper anyway at the April 1945 San Francisco conference, with the result that we had no policy officially adopted for the department. In turn, Truman showed no interest, and the British eased the path of the French return. "We silently gnashed our teeth," Moffat recorded, "but there was nothing that we could do about it." Such were the divisions and confusions when Japan finally surrendered in September 1945. For his part, Ho did everything right. The ICP held an all-party conference on August 13th through 16th at Tran Toa, inviting delegates from across Indochina. It was at this conference that Ho persuaded rival parties that the ICP alone enjoyed the all-important American imprimatur. This was untrue. This was followed by a National People's Conference in which the Viet Minh played a leading role. The outcome of this conference was the outline of a provisional government with Ho elected president. In an important symbolic move, the Viet Minh flag that would become so familiar to American soldiers was chosen as the national flag of an independent Vietnam. The presence of OSS agents suggested to the Viet Minh that the United States supported this move. A declaration of independence was made on the same day as the Japanese surrender on September 2nd. In direct imitation of the American Declaration of Independence, the speech began with the words, "All men are created equal. They are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights." With an astuteness characteristic of Ho, the September 2nd Declaration of Independence also contained allusions to the French 1793 Declaration of the Rights of Man, to the mortification of the French colonists in Hanoi. When Ho finished speaking, "An airplane, a small one, circled over us. We did not know whose plane it was. We thought it was a Vietnamese plane. But when it swooped down over us, we recognized the American flag." The crowd cheered enthusiastically. Medical student Tran Duy Hung was one of thousands present at the Declaration of Independence. He recalled, "On that day, Hanoi was so animated that I can say that I've not seen another day like that since. There was a forest of red banners all over the city. Beginning early in the morning, workers, peasants, and other segments of the population converged on the Ba Ding Square. Several days before the event took place, we built a simple platform above this flower bed. Around this square platform, we placed honor guards armed with sticks, there were very few guns, to provide security. On the outer ring, we had religious leaders from all the religious organizations, Buddhist monks in brown, Catholic priests in black, and nuns were holding their penance, looking as if they were conducting religious ceremonies in the pagodas. At the time, Hanoi had a population of 250,000 inhabitants who thronged to the area. The ceremony was supposed to start at 3 p.m., but was delayed because of the crowds. Eventually, Ho and the rest of the provisional government ascended the platform. A national anthem was played, and the flag of an independent Vietnam was raised for the first time, described by Hung as the most moving moment. Ho started to read the declaration, then asked, "Compatriots, can you hear me?" Because the rickety loudspeaker system was really very bad. "Yes, we hear you," the crowd roared back. Ho then delivered his famous Declaration of Independence with unassuming dignity. At the end, the excited crowds chanted, "Independence or death," a warning the French should have heeded. The shouts from the heart, which so impressed the Americans in Hanoi, became shouts of revenge across French Indochina, a landscape of chaos and random violence not fully painted by characters like Patti. The Japanese surrender on August 16th, rather than ushering in peace, had unleashed a wave of anarchy. Civil authority was handed over to the royal government, which then struggled to impose order. Seizing the moment, the Viet Minh had taken Hanoi on August 19th, followed by a second, less successful power grab 1 week later in Saigon. In reality, the Viet Minh had usurped an independence movement already set in motion by the Japanese-installed Kim government. In historian Arthur Dauman's verdict, many Vietnamese, especially in the south where Ho was not well known, in fact viewed the Viet Minh's actions as a Quoc Chin Quyen, or stealing of authority. Faced with the inevitable, Emperor Bao Dai abdicated, but not before warning de Gaulle as a friend that the cause of Vietnamese independence was irreversible and that no human force could deflect the destiny of his people. A warning blithely ignored by de Gaulle, who was already setting in train the dispatch of a French expeditionary corps to Indochina. Patti, who witnessed the events firsthand, took a more nuanced view. In a deeply superstitious and illiterate society, Bao Dai's abdication was less a legal affair and more a transference of the mandate from heaven to a new incumbent. According to Dauman, Bao Dai actually had no idea to whom he was abdicating, a measure of the confusion that now reigned in French Indochina. That the new intercessor was a communist was irrelevant and not understood anyway outside circles of intelligentsia. The reverence shown to Ho in the north and south stemmed from this heavenly intervention, viewed as an important article of faith among the Vietnamese peasantry. Bankrupted by war, de Gaulle's rescue force comprised a Corps Léger d'Intervention, Light Interventions Corps, a hopelessly undermanned and undertrained body in no position to reassert French authority. A point of acute sensitivity was the ethnic composition of the force. A French report noted that, as much to preserve French prestige, it was necessary that a strong proportion of the troops that liberated Indochina were white. But this was a problem. The Defense Committee could only make up the numbers by recruiting noir, blacks, suspected of being unreliable, and indigènes, locals, suspected of being disloyal. Allied bombing had destroyed the rail network between Saigon and Hanoi, and few roads were trafficable. Parts of the country, especially in the north, were facing the prospect of mass starvation. French civilians who had endured the Japanese occupation were being hunted down, beaten, and in the worst cases, raped and killed. Europeanized Vietnamese, perceived as collaborators of the old regime, suffered similar treatment. In an echo of the violence swirling in communist-held China, powerful landowners were attacked, and there was rioting in towns. The violence was exacerbated by severe monsoon flooding in the delta that resulted in the deaths of between 700,000 and 2 million Vietnamese peasants. In the south, the OSS was less welcome. Following the Japanese surrender, an old-style Vietnamese gangster called Tran Van Giao led a group of militias loosely affiliated within a United National Front, UNF, in a shooting spree across Cochin China. He was only halted from becoming the unchallenged ruling warlord by the rivalry of the Hoa Hao and Cao Dai. The vacuum of power was finally filled by advance elements of the British 20th Indian Division, arriving in Saigon on September 12th under the command of the square-jawed, very gentlemanly, very calm, Major General Douglas Gracie. For political reasons, a single French company drawn from 5th Colonial Infantry Regiment, 5th RIC in Ceylon, accompanied the British. Major Philip Mallins, a transport and supply officer who arrived on the first flight, remembered curiosity, some welcoming, and a slight feeling of apprehension. The Japanese had supplied a collection of large American automobiles at Tan Son Nhut Airport for the British. Mallins appropriated a Cadillac, drove to a hotel in central Saigon, and had some drinks. As he and his soldiers had just emerged from the hellish jungle fighting in Burma, it was literally like going into a beautiful slice of Paris. However, the city he arrived in was not a happy place. Saigon was home to a sizable colon population, as many as 15,000 Europeans, now fearful for their lives and enraged by Vietnamese aggression. The arrival of Western troops provoked general jubilation. Unused parachutes were handed over to Saigon's couturier-starved women to make dresses, and hidden stashes of Pernod and champagne were shared with the soldiers. In fact, the British arrived with no real specific orders, and remarkably, with less than a company of troops. It was a typically improvised affair. Ordinary Vietnamese who lined the streets, cheering the arrival of British troops, imagined an imminent independence. This delusion barely lasted 2 days. Madame Nguyen Thi Binh, a daughter of French-educated civil servants who later became the foreign minister of the National Liberation Front, recalled the deflation. I myself met some English officers, but those officers did not understand anything of the situation in our country. They were interested in other things, not in helping us. Rather, they were seeking pleasure. We saw that it was not with good intentions that those missions were coming to Saigon. And very soon, we saw that the Allies were precisely the people who were helping the French to come back. It was experiences such as these that pushed moderate intellectuals like Madame Bing to the communist flag. Later, she would be arrested by the French, tortured at the Sûreté on Katina Street, and jailed in the notorious Chi Hua prison for 3 years. Ironically, many of her National Liberation Front comrades would end up in this same hole after the communist victory in 1975. Gracie had fought in both world wars, won 2 military crosses, and spent virtually his entire career in the Indian Army. Even in the midst of the chaotic situation in Saigon, he insisted on formal Sunday mess dinners complete with turbans, pipes, and regimental colors. He represented a world that most Americans found incomprehensible, and his style of command was as archaic as his attitudes to the brown or yellow man. 2.5 million Indians had volunteered to serve the British Crown, a baffling proposition to most Americans. Gracie's innate sense of racial superiority was reinforced by the respect and loyalty of his colonial charges. Field Marshal Slim would remark that no Indian troops carried their tail more vertically than Gracie's. One subordinate observed, "They, the Indian soldiers, loved him. He absolutely loved them." He would eventually retire as Commander-in-Chief of Independent Pakistan's 1st National Army. Gracie had little patience for illegitimate pretensions to power, and none for the Viet Minh-installed Provisional Executive Committee, PEC, which he promptly kicked out of La Grandière Palace. "Communists," he harumphed by way of justification. In a typical gesture of British jocularity, the Gurkhas under his command nicknamed the Viet Minh the Vitamins. His brigade commander, the avuncular Doi Gestcourt Ted Taunton, recollected, "I had to balance 3 things. The Japanese, who were in charge of the key points, the French, who, having been released, were getting a little bit out of control, and the Annamites, who were sitting on the government buildings." His instructions were simple: get the French in and get the Annamites out. Backed by a Mountbatten who was keen to mollify the French, Gracie then set about rearming former soldiers of the 11th French Colonial Infantry, 11th RIC. This and subsequent actions led to the portrayal of Gracie as pro-French and anti-Vietnamese. Viscerally, he was. Gracie was heartily sick of the Viet Minh and the Annamites causing all this unrest and disturbance in Saigon. His overriding concern was restoring law and order, but he was not a maverick. He perfectly understood Britain's neutrality in French Indochina, as well as the difficulties of maintaining it. Crucially, British administrators were not prepared to legally hand over territory seized from the French ally by a Japanese enemy to an unelected and self-proclaimed government, however much the Viet Minh protested it represented the wishes of the people. A secret memo from General Leclerc captured the good relationship that was quickly struck with Gracie, his abstention from politics, and the essence of his mission, which was re-establishing law and order. "I have up to now the best relations with Major General Gracie and his officers. It is evident that above all he wants to sort out the Japanese question. Then, and only when we have sufficient forces, we will work towards the establishment of French authority. Also, without any doubt, the English are abstaining, and will abstain from any political action. They will maintain law and order, but will step aside to let us order the other questions." Even so, the decision to rearm the French provoked a violent local response and the random killing of civilians. A subsequent release of French prisoners on September 23rd led to a de facto counter-coup and further violence, led by the French acting High Commissioner of Cochin China, Jean-Marie Arsène Sédil, and now directed against Vietnamese. 80th British Brigade actively supported this French action, seizing the Garde Civile barracks, as well as the Yokohama and Indochina banks. Mobs in the Cité Hérault district of Saigon duly reacted to this French coup by massacring 150 civilians. Faced with a spiraling rebellion in Saigon, Gracie then struck an unlikely alliance with the charming Lieutenant General Takuzo Numata, co-opting the 40,000-strong Japanese garrison to maintain order. This was a highly controversial but forced decision, given the lack of white troops. Until October, Gracie was allocated just 1,800 soldiers to secure various locations in southern Vietnam and the capital of Cambodia. In Brigadier Taunton's recollection, blame lay with the rampaging Gallic ally rather than with the Annamites. The French, being an excitable nation, started to become trigger-happy, and it was then that it was necessary to put control back in the hands of the Japanese. Indeed, the British seemed to warm to the Japanese, who were well-behaved and disciplined, unlike almost all other armed groups, including the French, on the streets of Saigon. Newspapers were closed down, and a curfew was imposed. British liaison with the Japanese was somewhat complicated by also having to deal with the Southern Army commander, a truculent Marshal Terauchi, as well as the dull-witted Saigon garrison commander, General Manaki. As the Japanese had deliberately set about arming nationalists in the last days of the war, the irony of this reversal of fortunes escaped no one. Not least the elderly Numata, who rode about the streets of Saigon on a splendid white charger, enjoying a certain schadenfreude over the difficulties the British were now facing. French civilians with minimal military training also joined in the running street battles. When the Viet Minh broke a truce on October 10th, Gracie lost all forbearance, and any hopes of parleying with communists ended. If Gracie showed little patience with the troublesome Viet Minh and other roaming militias, he displayed even less tolerance for an interfering American called Lieutenant Colonel Peter Dewey. The youthful Dewey, son of a congressman, had ostensibly arrived in Saigon to recover American POWs, but he also appeared to be providing moral support to Vietnamese nationalists fighting for liberty, a dubious concept to Gracie. In fact, there was no exact translation of the Western concept of liberty in Vietnamese. The closest word was tu do, which meant license, and which commonly appeared over the bordellos in downtown Saigon. French intelligence also soon picked up on Dewey. It was noted that his presence evidently had another motive, and that his intervention had the likelihood of greatly annoying the English. It wasn't just the English who were annoyed. Dewey, like his fellow OSS officer Patty in Hanoi, seemed to be disliked by his own team. When Gracie discovered the ulterior purpose of Dewey's mission, he declared him persona non grata, requested he leave the country, and forbade the flying of an American flag on his jeep. This latter order was later attributed as the cause of Dewey's death on September 26th, when he was possibly mistaken for a French officer and shot by Annamite rebels near Tan Son Nhut Airport, north of Saigon. Another theory suggests that he was actually killed by Cao Dai nationalists because of his well-known support for the Viet Minh. The facts were that Dewey decided to drive back to Saigon for lunch after being notified that his midday flight was delayed, and he took a shortcut despite warnings over the safety of the route. When the jeep came across a roadblock, Dewey shook his fist and yelled something in French. A burst of machine gun fire struck him in the back of the head and took away most of his lower jaw. A patrol from 3-1 Gurkhas almost succeeded in recovering the body, but arrived too late. For the next 2 weeks, an intensive search was made of morgues, but all that was found was French planters with hands or feet cut off or with slit throats. Dewey achieved posthumous fame as America's first combat fatality in Vietnam. This claim ignores the several American POWs and aviators who died in Vietnam over the course of the war. The first American combat fatality on Vietnamese soil may have been a shot-down aviator, only known as Henry, who was killed by Japanese troops in the Central Highlands sometime after March 9, 1945. Peter Dewey's last reported message to his controller was remarkably brief, honest, and prophetic. Cochin China is burning. The French and British are finished here, and we ought to clear out of Southeast Asia. The chaotic events of September 1945 led to the missed opportunity fallacy, but the reality was that the OSS, charmed by Ho, had run away with the script. Independence for the states of French Indochina had been championed by Roosevelt, but this impulse depended on his survival and the compliance of allies. Neither survived the war. It had been at Roosevelt's insistence that Article 3 had been included in the 1941 Atlantic Charter, pledging a post-war settlement in which all peoples would enjoy the right to self-determination. This had stuck in Churchill's craw, a committed colonialist, but a desperate British Commonwealth needed the American giant, and there was plenty of time to manipulate the game. Over the next few years, Churchill chipped away at Washington's post-war proposals, and Roosevelt's untimely death then removed the last obstacle to European objections to the Charter. At the April 1945 San Francisco conference, Indochina was not raised. In May, Secretary of State Stettinius advised his French counterpart that Washington would remain innocent over the question of French Indochina. In June, American non-interference was officially endorsed in a State Department paper affirming that the United States recognizes French sovereignty over Indochina. By the Potsdam Conference in July, Truman had publicly abandoned Roosevelt's Atlantic Charter and bowed to French sensitivities, agreeing to divide the country along the 16th parallel, with French forces eventually taking over from the British in the south. In the north, nationalist Chinese forces under American supervision would impose order as an interim solution to a final settlement. The temporary arrangement did not sit well with the French, who were not informed of the decision until after it was made. Nevertheless, this was a retreat from what Roosevelt had considered to be the only just solution to Vietnam, trusteeship followed by independence, a position repeated in the Cairo, Tehran, and Yalta conferences. Ho could have been forgiven for believing American promises. Fearful of the implications to the Commonwealth, British intransigence in the last 2 years of the war ultimately checkmated an America too preoccupied with Japan. De Gaulle, in his imperial robes, simply ignored all initiatives proposing independence in the colonial territories. In the immediate aftermath of the war, America had few realistic options other than to cede Southeast Asia to former colonial powers. Truman, who did not share Roosevelt's anti-Gallicism, in turn lost all interest in the matter. Notwithstanding these double dealings, it is highly unlikely that an American administration would have found a comfortable ally in Vietnamese communists who were beginning to impose a violent totalitarianism on the French colony. Having only just served out his first 100 days in office, Truman hardly had the time or inclination to attend to the missives of an Indo-Chinese nationalist he had never heard of. Over 1945 to 46, Ho Chi Minh would write 8 letters to the U.S. government pleading for help. All were ignored. The sense of betrayal from this cold shouldering was not forgotten. French prickliness and long memories over Roosevelt's proposal for trusteeships also ran deep. When the last French troops finally withdrew from Vietnam in 1956, France's foreign minister bitterly recalled the policy, as if the shambles and tragedy of the last 10 years had all been an American plot. In the aftermath of Ho's August Revolution, American policy toward Indochina remained broadly, if uneasily, supportive of France. But there were limits to this tolerance. The Navy stipulated that no U.S.-flagged vessel be permitted to transport French war materiel or soldiers to Vietnam. American troops in Vietnam were authorized to conduct humanitarian operations, but were forbidden to offer assistance to the beleaguered French. In a contradictory stance, a growing lobby in the State Department's Far Eastern desk argued strongly for a restoration of French rule, a position supported by other European desks which saw the merits of a strong France in a now tense and divided Europe. In the South, the French were able to reestablish control quickly, thanks to the supportive British and because the Viet Minh overplayed its hand. Led by Nguyen Binh, the Viet Minh had never enjoyed the same level of popularity in the South. Crucially, the French were able to enlist loyalists to their side, notably a former teacher, Nguyen Van Tam, the Tiger of Cai Lệ, who brutally suppressed his own countrymen and was rewarded with the governorship of Tonkin. Tam effectively became the godfather of the nascent South Vietnamese army. In the north, the presence of Chinese nationalist troops, rather than the limited French military response, derailed Ho's plans to establish an independent state. In Hanoi, Patty was replaced by Carlton Swift, a former naval officer. Much like his predecessor, Swift quickly came to the conclusion that the black-and-white portrayal of Ho Chi Minh as ardent communist was an exaggeration. The reality of Ho's politics and Vietnamese relations with the French was far more mixed than an impatient official in Washington might bother to understand. Vietnam was the last thing anybody in Washington wanted or would even read. Swift's pen picture of Ho was remarkably accurate and ignored. Ho was basically a nationalist concerned for his people. He was not hateful of the French. He certainly wanted to run things by Lenin's book, but this only caused problems because the State Department could not see grays, only the black and white of communists versus the free world. Swift's personal encounters with the ascetic, thin intellectual Ho left him posing the question that many contemporaries asked. Why is this man a leader? Why is this wisp of a man such a significant force? He was never able to answer the question. Following complaints by Jean Saint-Denis over American agitation, a charge which left Swift outraged, the OSS station was removed from Hanoi in October to soothe French sensibilities. The loss of the station, which included 5 native speakers, effectively left Washington clueless over the subsequent unfolding events. These events took a turn for the worse. Historic Sino-Vietnamese antagonism was exacerbated by the fact that the occupying Chinese soldiers received little or no pay and were subsisting at the end of a dreadful logistic chain. Hanoi resident Bui Tin, who later rose to the rank of colonel in the North Vietnamese Army, recalled the Chinese as a miserable sight, riffraff elements dressed in rags. On one occasion, he was amused to observe a group of soldiers pierce open some tins of paint and take a drink, thinking them to be cans of condensed milk. They just poured down the streets of Hanoi and looted, taking everything they could get their hands on. Thus, what started out as an internationally recognized and temporary arrangement degenerated into countrywide vandalism and looting by 150,000 ill-fed troops, commanded by the warlord General Lu Han. 4 Chinese columns eventually descended into Tonkin, comprising the 52nd, 62nd, 93rd, and 60th Armies. Wedemeyer had planned that only the latter should remain as a garrison force, but the opportunity to make money from the lucrative opium poppy harvest extended their stay. Chinese internal politics also interfered with the plan. As many as 2/3 of the Chinese soldiers were ethnic Yunnanese who owed their loyalty to a General Lung Yun, a rival of the nationalist leader Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek. The latter duly exploited the situation and deposed Yun from the nationalist government. The American general assigned as Lujan's mentor, Philip Gallagher, found himself caught between the rapacity of the Chinese troops, a restless civilian population inflamed by Viet Minh propaganda, and the growing assertiveness of the French. Gallagher's task was made harder by financial meltdown, exacerbated by a 500-piaster note crisis, a scam fomented by Chinese army officers manipulating currency exchange rates. It was only with the greatest difficulty and tact that Gallagher was able to restore financial stability, and with some relief that the U.S. advisory mission was finally withdrawn from Hanoi on December 12, 1945. Trapped by this deteriorating situation, Ho's position became untenable. Unable to expel the Chinese who had previously backed him with arms and supplies, he had little choice but to seek settlement with the French authorities. The British looked on and lamented the unfortunate developments, but did not interfere. By February 1946, Gracie and his Gurkhas were gone. This opened the way for the March 6, 1946 peace deal, which appeared to offer hope. The Chinese agreed to withdraw, their place taken by French troops for an unspecified period. In return, France recognized Ho Chi Minh as President of the Republic of Vietnam and promised to negotiate a final solution to the question of Vietnam's status. At the heart of this agreement was the promise of elections, which the Communists anticipated they would win. As the Viet Minh had won 60% of the vote and 182 of 302 seats in the January National Assembly elections, this was an entirely realistic prospect. The fate of French Indochina was now in the hands of two men hand-picked by de Gaulle, but perversely at odds with each other. Military command was invested in the high Catholic Philippe-François-Marie, Comte de Haute-Cloque, a man with a pinched mouth and pencil moustache, better known by his wartime alias, Leclerc. His ancestors had fought in the Crusades, and he would add one last and brief chapter to this family history. The post of High Commissioner fell in the lap of Vice-Admiral Georges Thierry d'Argentlieu, a former Carmelite monk, described by one critic as having the most brilliant mind in the 12th century. Leclerc arrived in Saigon with the intention of restoring French authority, but came to the conclusion that the hate of the yellow for the white was immovable. The pig-headed d'Argentlieu shot off on an opposite track, tearing up the Free State promises of March 6th, and with Chile hauteur informing the Vietnamese, "France does not intend in the present state of evolution of the Indochinese people to give them unconditional and total independence, which would only be a fiction gravely prejudicial to the interests of the two parties." D'Argentlieu then played a role not dissimilar to that of some American officials in the later war, convinced that military success was not only possible, but the necessary precondition to political dialogue. However, his chief and original sin was the peremptory establishment of a separate Nam Bo, South Vietnam, intolerable to the Communists and indeed to the majority of Southerners.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.